Hola, buenas noches. Good evening. My name is Abelardo de la Peña Jr. I'm the Director of Marketing and Communications with La Plaza de Cultura y Artes, welcoming you to tonight's En Casa con La Plaza. It's a real special one. We'll talk about it in a little while. First of all, thank you. Those of you who have joined us on Zoom, please, you have the comment section right there, the chat feature to ask questions, make comments, the Q&A. Take questions now, take them later. Facebook, thanks for joining us as well. Use the comment section, let us know where you're viewing from. Also, you could do shout outs, make comments, ask questions, and we'll pass them on to our guests as the night progresses. All right, En Casa con la Plaza is our virtual programming. Been at it since April of 2020, and we're gonna continue doing it until the foreseeable future. Presentations, demonstrations, conversations, and today, a combination of a conversation and performances. All right, we gotta thank our November En Casa sponsors, CVS Health, Aetna, United Union Pacific Foundation. Funding has also been provided by the California Humanities and the National Endowment for the Humanities as part of the American Rescue Plan Act of 2021, and also a new sponsor, the Institute of Museum and Library Services, advancing, supporting, and empowering America's museums, libraries, and related organizations. A couple updates about La Plaza. We're open every day except for Tuesday. During the week, from 12 to 5. On weekends, tomorrow and Sunday, from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. For your viewing pleasure and also for your buying pleasure, La Plaza Tienda is also open. All of our exhibits are open. Carlos Almaraz, LA Starts Here, Camp Principal. One of our newer exhibits, Patriotism and Conflict, opened a couple Saturdays ago. And just this week, we installed Frank Romero's Going to the 1984 Olympics. If you've gone down the Hollywood Freeway around downtown LA on the north side, close to where Union Station is, this beautiful mural that has come and then it's gone, then it's come and it's gone again. Currently it's painted over, but you could check out the original painting that it's based on there at La Plaza de Cultura y Artes on the second floor. Also, no programming from La Plaza this weekend, but we do have going on right now, the Trans Latina Coalition is hosting their Garras 2021 fundraiser. It's an excellent organization fighting for the rights of our Trans Latina community. And so they have their fashion show going on as we speak. In a couple weeks from now, on December the 3rd, we do have the International Mariachi Women's Festival. And that's a La Plaza co-produced event. And that should be a great one. It's free. It's on a Saturday evening. And just keep watching out here in Casa con la Plaza and also on our website and our Facebook page to learn all about what's going on. All right. So let's get down to the business for today. I'm going to talk about who we have as our guest. And if I could find my little notes here, Jesus, Decibel Studios was founded in 2017 by producer, engineer, musician, Jesus Martinez, seeking a new way to promote the music and musicians that he loves during the pandemic. Martinez started The Breakfast Table, a streaming event that showcases LA's rising stars within the Latino musical community, performing live in his living room. Join us, and you're here today to share some of the music he's created at this unique venue. And also, another connection is he's the recipient, Decibel Studios is the recipient of an Eastside Arts Initiative grant, which we'll talk about in a little while. So without further ado, let's bring up Jesus Martinez. Come on up, Jesus.
Hey, what's up, everyone? Abelardo, ¿cómo estás?
Pues yo bien, ¿y tú?
Bien, bien, aquí nomás, hanging out, ya sabes.
All right, hey, you're talking about, things were kind of slow earlier in the month, but now things are picking up. Tell us what's going on.
Yeah, things are picking up, luckily. You know, I'm a musician here in Los Angeles. Not only am I an engineer, producer, but I also perform live music with Tres Souls. But yeah, things are picking up in a sense that there's been some projects that have came to me for me to arrange some music for different songwriters and singers. And so that's pretty exciting. And then things are starting to pick up a little bit as well with the Tres Souls and me playing live around the city.
All right, well, let's begin there. You started playing at a very early age. Tell us about it.
Yeah, I began to play requinto specifically when I was 11 years old. And I got lucky because my dad plays that instrument as well. So ever since I was a little kid, I had bolero music and trio music in my life. And my dad would play at family parties with my older cousins. And so that was always part of my life. And I always liked the music. And so when I turned 11, I decided, okay, I really got into Rage Against the Machine. I thought, okay, I'm gonna start playing guitar. And my dad started teaching me boleros, and, you know, I loved it. And ever since then, it's just been a passion of mine to just play and play and play. And, you know, I would practice all these songs by myself because I didn't have anyone in my age group that necessarily played the music. But I always loved it so much. And it wasn't until after college when I met my bandmates, Rocio and Roberto, when I started to play bolero trio music in a live setting.
All right. Well, real quickly, for those who aren't in the know, tell us what a requinto is.
Yeah, a requinto is a specific instrument that was actually designed by one of Los Panchos, El Güero Gil, in the 1940s. And so this instrument has, Latin roots. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, it was a mixture of like a classical guitar and a Colombian instrument. And so it's just like a guitar, but it's a little bit smaller. The scale is a little bit smaller, and it's tuned higher than a guitar, so it takes the lead in trio romántico music. And so it's the instrument that you hear when you hear Los Panchos, Los Tres Haces, Los Tres Reyes. That's what a requinto is.
Oh, it's a little high, those high notes that are just so melodic. They carry, they accompany, of course, the singer, who's correct, usually the main focal point of a trio. But they also are a solo instrument in themselves.
Yeah, that's correct. You know, it takes the lead in bolero, trio, romantico music. And like you said, you know, when there's a singer, you know, singers always take the lead in everything when we're speaking about music, right? But what the requinto does, it's almost like they're having a conversation. The singer sings, there's a little bit of space, the requinto then fills in a melodic line. And it usually is, a solo in the beginning, the music starts, some filling of melodic lines, and then there's a solo in the middle, more melodic lines within the chorus and the verses, and that's usually the combination of what a trio romántico song is.
All right. And you kind of glossed over this, you know, you went to school, then you came back, but tell us about your school experience.
Yeah, you know, I've been very, very blessed to have a family that, like, you know, has really pushed me to follow my dreams, from my father that taught me music, to my mother that has always been very supportive about that, to my sister who she's only 2 years older than I am, but she was like my counselor, always pushed me like, hey, get this class, hey, go do this, hey, go do that. So I was very blessed to have that type of family. And I went to Berklee College of Music, and a funny story was that I had never heard of that school. I was already a senior. I had never heard of that school. And one of the guitar teachers at my high school, she was like, hey, Berklee's going to be in LA. You should go check them out. I'll give you a field trip slip. At that point, I was already driving. So she's like, I'll give you a field trip slip and you could go. And honestly, I was like, cool. I don't get to come to school. All right, I'll go. And, you know, honestly. So I grabbed one of my friends. We both went and I was just blown away. So what they do is they have student bands go all over the U.S. and promote the school in that way. And I was blown away by the way that these college students were playing. And I thought, oh, man, I need to go to this school. And so if I'm not mistaken, that was already December, January of my senior year, you know. So I started looking into it and I realized that I had passed the auditions in Los Angeles. But having the sister that I have, she pushed my mom and convinced my mom to let us go to Boston. I was 17. My sis was like 19. We set a little hostel. I did the audition and, you know, I was blessed enough to get in and I studied music engineering and production at Berklee.
Wow. Well, Berklee, as opposed to the UC Berklee, Berklee is B-E-R-K-L-E-E. It's located in Boston. It's one of the preeminent music schools in the nation, if not the world. So congrats on that.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. And what made you choose the production and engineering aspect?
Yeah, you know, I had never really known much about the production side nor the engineering side you know, when I was in middle school to high school, I didn't have that experience. I never went into a studio or anything like that. But when I got to Berkeley, you know, they kind of give you the rundown of what the majors are. And I was very still not sure what I was going to do. At that point, I had very little experience in anything in music other than like playing, you know, in a garage band or like playing, you know, in my room. But when they started to explain the process of studio time and the process of mixing music, I was like, wow, you know what? This is something that's very interesting to me. The details are specifically in the mixing of music. That's what really got me hooked in. I was like, you know what? I think I could do this and I want to do this. And so when I got there, you have to also apply to get into the engineering program. I guess that, you know, everybody wants to do it. I don't know. But you have to also apply and you have to, you know, do your write-ups and you have an interview and everything. It's like getting into Berkeley again almost. And so, you know, once I started to understand that world a little bit more and kind of gloss into it, I was like, oh, yeah, this is what I want to do. And you know, I was lucky enough to get in and study.
All right. So then you came back to back home, basically, and started playing. And your first hookup was with Roberto and Los Tres Souls. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. I came back trying to figure out what I was going to do, doing a lot of interning at studios. That wasn't going very good in my experiences at these studios. And I was just like, kind of like, almost like kind of just like floating, not knowing exactly what to do. And my sister, she was studying Chicano studies and she did a paper on how music keeps culture in a Chicano's life. And so she interviewed me about, you know, me playing requinto and all of that stuff. And she happened to share the story in her paper with her class. And Roberto's friend was in that class. And so she was like, hey, my friend's looking for a requintista. Your brother plays. They should link up. And they exchanged our phone numbers. And then Roberto gives me a call. He's like, hey, are you interested? I was like, yeah, dude. But I'm like, you got to know I'm rusty, man. Like, I haven't really practiced. Because remember, at this point, I was trying to intern and do the engineering thing more than anything. So I wasn't practicing my instrument as much because I was trying to do something else, right? And he was like, yeah, no, it's cool. And so I got to work. They gave me, like, their song list. I knew probably, like, 30% of it, maybe even 25% of it. So I started to like work. At that point, I was working at Home Depot. And I remember I would take my instrument to practice during lunch to just try to catch up. And I had like two or three rehearsals with Roberto, just me and Roberto. And then eventually Rocio came in and we started to play. And, you know, we started to get a groove and gel together as musicians. And, you know, they really did help me a lot to grow as a musician. That
wrong. All right. Well, just to let people out there know, Los Tres Souls have appeared here in En Casa con La Plaza. So check us out on our YouTube page at La Plaza in LA and also on our Facebook page. And you'll see a very intimate performance by Los Tres Souls and you could experience the music for yourself. So let's jump a little ahead of about what we're talking about today, which is the breakfast table and Decibel Studios. Tell us how that came about.
Right. So Decibel Studios came about because I always had that hunger to do more engineering, to do more mixing and all of that. And so when it came to Tres Souls making a record, I thought, well, I got some gear. I'm going to try this out. Right. I'm going to record our first EP. I'm going to engineer it and produce it. And so we started to get to work on that record with Tres Souls. And I believe that was in 2018 when we started to work on it and come up with different ideas and all of that. Where we actually just mixed in a little bit of like the Cinema de Oro de Mexico with bolero music. And we added some electric guitars to bolero music and all these things. It's just little things that I always want to kind of like sparkle up the music. And so once I did that, I was like, hey, you know what? I can make some records here. I can make some songs here in this studio that I have here, in this small room. And so I decided to like, okay, you know what? I'm open up to the public. I'm gonna see what we could do. And so we started doing all of that. And yeah, sure enough, little by little, people started calling me to do different arrangements and that sort of thing. And then the pandemic hit and things just like slowed down for everyone. And there was no live shows. So I thought, you know, this room is pretty small, right? So when musicians come and record, we usually go over any musical idea, chord progression, whatever it could be, in my living room, which is like shared with my living room and my kitchen. And I have a breakfast table there. And so I was like, hey, you know what? I was talking to one of my good friends, Oscar Almaguer, who has recorded here, awesome singer. And he was like, yeah, you know what? You should do something like that. And so when the pandemic hit, I was like, okay, I'm gonna try this out. I'm gonna invite, I decided to invite, the first one was Lupita Infante, which, you know, she's a good friend. I've known her for some years. And I hit her up, told her the idea. She was like, yeah, let's do it. And so, you know, she got her musicians. And then I also contacted my friend Adán Alonso, and he was just starting to do some camera work. And so I was like, hey, would you be interested in doing something like this? Like, we should try it out. He was like, yeah. So we all got together and we did the first episode, which I believe was in September or August of 2020. And yeah, you know, I enjoyed it so much. And I really liked the results that we were getting, both audio, visual, and everything. And so it just kind of started to go like that. And I started to invite more people to come and play live music, because at that point there was no live music.
Well, this that first episode is the bomb. That's what got us interested in the breakfast table. So why don't you go ahead and share that session with us, a little bit of that.
Yeah, so we're going to see Lupita Infante and friends, and they're going to be playing this original song of hers. So let me pull that up for you all to enjoy. Let's see. All right, here we go.
Yes, share screen.
Share screen.
Click on the two little buttons at the bottom. There you go.
There we go.
All right, I'm going to go over here.
Un poco como nunca.
awesome. That was pretty nice.
Yeah, Lupita Infante, there she is.
Yeah, Lupita Infante, for those that you don't know, granddaughter of the iconic Pedro Infante. Also, of course, a singer, Grammy-nominated singer. In fact, she sang at the Latin Grammys last night. Good friend of La Plaza. She was our headliner entertainer at our gala just this last September. What a stage presence, what a wonderful personality, and what a voice.
Truly, truly, truly. Yeah, it's always a pleasure to work with her. We've done a couple of things, and, you know, I hope we continue to work on stuff. Yeah, she's awesome.
Yeah. All right. Well, Lupita, as somebody you knew, you seem to know a lot of musicians. Of course, in your line of work, you run into to people that are asking for your assistance as an arranger and a producer. How do you select the ones that you're going to feature on the breakfast table?
You know, one of the things that is important for me is that I try my best. Sometimes it doesn't work out, but I do try my best to make it like each one of these videos almost like a playlist. Curate a playlist. One of the things that I've always been very fond of in the city of LA is the music and the variety of music that it has. And it has a lot of variety. But, you know, I started off with Lupita Infante because I thought this is going to be the perfect person to start this off with. Then I ended up doing some things with like Los Hermanos Herrera, Chamuy Majadero, and all these different, because I specifically started with folk Latin music, because that's, you know, bolero music is folk Latin music. So I thought, let's focus on that. And then also too, like, those are my friends, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. I know them because of the scene that we're in. So I thought, you know, that shouldn't be too crazy to get them on in that sense. But I also then reached out. There is a tremendous, beautiful scene of oldie soul music in Southern California. And, you know, I've been following that scene for a little bit now. And I was like, man, that would be awesome to have on the breakfast table, because that's so LA, that's so California. It's such a beautiful genre that I think should be exposed to the world, you know. So I was very lucky to contact the Altons, and that was almost like a cold call, you know, because I didn't know any of them. But I reached out to them on social media and they reached back, and, you know, we worked it out for them to come on and do a session with us.
All right, well, let's listen to this one.
Yeah, let's get to this one. All right, sorry, y'all, I'm a little bit slow with my, okay. Then we go back to this. Ay, ay, ay. Okay, here we go, y'all, here we go.
All right. We'll be right back.
not your problem. It's not your problem.
You said you would sometime.
You keep on running. You keep on running.
You said you would someday. It's not your problem. It's not your problem.
Soul oldies. That's not that recent a genre. It's like a progression of a musical style that has existed within our community for a long time. But yeah. These guys, the Altons, the Sinceres, and others have taken it to another place, adding a little modernity, some youthful energy in it, and that was a killer cut.
Yeah, they have it. You know, they just have it, and. It's really cool, you know, their whole process, you know, their whole record label, the whole thing, even the way that they actually record their music, it's all analog, all to actual tape, like it was done back in the day. And they just released a single, so y'all got to go check it out. It's a beautiful song.
All right. Well, you know, one different, something that is really striking about what you're playing is the really pristine sound. Of that's coming from of course the singing and the instrumentation, but what's coming through is incredible. I mean, these Zoom sessions, you get all kinds of different qualities, but now you got it. What's your secret of being able to get the sound that sounds good to you, but get it across through this medium?
Yeah, you know, the main thing, the first thing is whoever's singing, whoever's playing. I mean, that right there is like 70% of it, you know, honestly. And that's one of the reasons why I feel so grateful doing the breakfast table, the amount of talent that comes by. But of course, you know, you have to have a certain amount of talent, but then it also goes down to the type of microphones that are being used. Usually about 90% of the time, when I record these sessions, I use two microphones. And so these two microphones give the voice, I use two microphones specifically on vocals. And it gives the vocal a little bit more warmth and presence. And so that's what you're hearing through these microphones. Come with like a power supply, because they have to get powered through a specific power supply. Each microphone has a different power supply. And so that's a lot of where what engineers call the warmth, that tone that you hear. And then also I use outboard preamplifiers, and the way that I describe preamplifiers is when you have an electric guitar and you play it, you can't really hear it without an actual amplifier, right? To turn up the signal of the guitar. And if you have a nice guitar, but your amplifier might not be so good, you won't get a very good tone. But if you have a good guitar and you have a good amplifier, that's when you could start shaping and getting some really nice warm tones. And so that combination of a two microphone that I really love to use on vocals with a nice preamplifier put together, it's magical, honestly.
All right. And you are a I don't know if they call them in the music world a gearhead.
You know, oh, I'm somebody.
Okay. I know you post like these unboxing videos where you're bringing out your new gear, and that's incredible. You know, somebody who loves music but isn't all that technical about it. I really enjoy what you're sharing with everybody when it comes to, you know, presenting what you're doing in your studio.
Thank you. Yeah, I really appreciate that. And, you know, it's one of those things that, like, you know, I don't know much, but what I do know, you know, I would love to share it. You know, there's been, you know, younger kids that hit me up like, hey, what should I do with this or that, you know, whether it's requinto or arranging or mixing and all of that. So yeah, you know, I've been lucky to have really good like mentors along the way, and then even now that, like, you know, I'm posting more stuff and being more active on social media about the arranging and mixing and all of that stuff, there's been some engineers that you know are older than me that have hit me up and just have these like awesome conversations about the recording world. And then also being like a Latino in the recording world, you know, because that's not such a, you know, we don't see that so much, especially like in American music, you know? And so, you know, we touch base on all of that stuff. And I just think that, you know, that those conversations are really good for growth for all of us.
That's good to hear that there's a bit of a network being created here. All right. Well, what do you got next?
All right, what I got next? Yeah. So this next breakfast table session that I'm going to show you guys was actually just me getting together with a bunch of my musician friends and making music. One of the genres that I have always loved very much is hip hop music. You know, growing up in Los Angeles, you hear that all over. And my good friends in high school were really into underground hip hop music, not necessarily the music that you hear on the radio. And so this whole world like really intrigued me. And I started to get into this genre that I didn't really know about. And one thing that was really cool, there was a lot of sampling going on within that genre, right? They get music from the 70s, from the 60s, the 50s. They get music from all over the world, and then they chop up the music and make their own style. And that always blew my mind. I always loved, and I was very intrigued of how hip hop music just came to be. And so then I started to get into the artists that they would sample. And I got heavy into soul music. I started just following, you know, like the Marvin Gaye's, the Jimmy Ruffins, the David Ruffins, all of these old soul guys that were just ridiculously talented. And so one thing that I always wanted to do was get soul music and bolero music and fuse them together. And so that's what I try to do with this rendition of Hermoso Cariño. This is actually not a bolero, it's a ranchera. But we took it and I did my best to try to make it with that neo soul kind of vibe. So instead of using an acoustic guitar, we use an electric guitar. We have drums and then three-part harmony with the beautiful singers that came by and blessed the show. So this is Hermoso Cariño. It's Decibel Collective. That's what I named the collective of musicians that we all just came together. So I hope y'all enjoy it.
All right.
Let's see what we got going on here. There I go again. Where did you go? There you are. Okay, here we go.
Hermoso cariño. Hermoso cariño. Que Dios ha mandado. Ser destinado no más para mí, precioso.
Amen. That was exquisite. All right. Jesus, are you there? There you go. Hey, that was beautiful. My gosh. The harmonies were just spot on. Who was the lineup on vocals there?
Yeah, the lineup on vocals was Rocio, my bandmate from Tres Souls, leading the ladies. We have Rosalie Rodriguez, which, you know, I've played with her here and there around the city, and Mary Alfaro, which also I've played with around the city, and I actually produced her album that will be coming out soon. So Rocio, Mary, and Rosalie, beautiful.
Oh, man. Did you record Mary's Cien Años?
I did, yeah. Oh,
a recent single just came out, Apple Music and other services as well. Check it out. It's Mary Alfaro Velasco with Cien Años. It's going to blow you away. It's beautiful, beautiful music.
Yeah, she did. She did a great job. She's actually playing a requinto on that song as well and singing lead. So, yeah, super talented.
All right. Well, let's see. We got another one here. Yeah. Tell us about the Trio Los Semejantes.
Yeah, so this was a pretty interesting story for sure. You know, I've been busy on social media, putting up videos of me playing requinto and all of that. And, you know, the hashtag thing really works. You know, I put like hashtag requinto, requinto romantico. And I got in contact with this young man. And he's from Mexico. We start going back and forth, and he starts telling me like, oh yeah, you know, I play bolero music too. And we start talking about it. And he tells me, he's like, hey, you know what? My dad is going to be in LA. Maybe you guys could do something. And so I was like, yeah, who's your dad? So we started sending me these links of Trio Los Semejantes from Mexico City. And I thought, oh man, these guys would be amazing to be on the breakfast table. You know, us Tres Souls, us playing bolero music, I think, you know, we do our best to try to stay within the lines of bolero music, but then also to try to change it up a little bit to kind of give it our own spin. But Los Semejantes, I just feel they're like, you know, old school bolero music. You know, they did it like the guys back in the day, and a lot of these guys played with Los Tres Aces and played with Los Tres Reyes and sung with Los Tres Reyes. So they've been in the scene for years as musicians. And I was just so lucky to have them come over and play a couple of songs with us. And it was just really cool. Like, just, you know, they're saying stories like how they began to play music and when they first heard this song. And there's so many similarities, even though we're far in age, and I didn't grow up in Mexico, I grew up in Los Angeles, but the similarities are still there, like as far as like how we began our musical career, and we had, you know, this bond in bolero music. So it was a really, really fun session. And then my pops came over for that one too, to just kind of enjoy the music, and it was just cool all around, good vibes. But this next song that we're about to hear, they took a banda song and they made it into a bolero. So it's a Banda MS song, El Color de Tus Ojos, is the name of the song. And so, yeah, I hope you guys enjoy it. Here we go.
Tus ojos despertó mi interés y solo tengo ganas de verte otra vez. Dime que no está prohibido, quizá me animo y te pido verte el sábado a las 10. El color de tus ojos se robó mi atención, te vas metiendo dentro de mi corazón. Perfecta en cualquier sentido,
con pantalón o vestido robas mi respiración. ¿Qué más quisiera que fueras el sueño que se vuelve realidad? Me gustas tanto y esa es toda la verdad. Me siento emocionado, no sé si te ha pasado, que si pudiera te viera de lunes a domingo sin parar. Esto que siento no se puede comparar. Y si ves que me sonrojo, si te burlas no me enojo. Yo solo sé que de ti me enamoré. Quisiera que fueras el sueño que se vuelve realidad. Me gustas tanto y esa es toda la verdad. Me siento emocionado, no sé si te ha pasado, que si pudiera te viera de lunes a domingo sin parar. Esto que siento no se puede comparar. Si ves que me sonrojo, si te burlas no me enojo. Yo solo sé que de ti me enamoré.
Eso mero. Oh, that was beautiful. Oh.
Yeah, that was they're really amazing, man. They're full of knowledge and yeah, it was just really cool just even to chop it up with them.
Yeah, a couple things there. First of all, the power of social media. First of all, you connect with one of the sons who connects you with the dad. Which one was the father of your friend?
The lead singer, the one, Don Martin, right in the middle.
All right. And what instrument was he playing?
The one on the left. I'm sorry. He was the one on the left. Yeah.
All right. And the one in the middle, he had it was a four-stringed instrument. Which instrument is that?
Yeah, it's actually a bass. It's pretty cool. I actually just bought one of those because of that. But it's a bass in a ukulele scale. And what they do is they use these, I wish I had it on me so I could show y'all, but it's almost like a rubber string. It's not like a winded string like a regular bass would have. It's almost like a rubber string, and that's where it gets like the low end, and that's how you can get so low with such a small scaled instrument.
That's pretty cool.
It's really cool because the way that I like to record it is I record it, it's also electric, so you can connect it to, let's say, a speaker, right? So I connect that directly into my computer, and then I put a microphone in front of it while I'm playing it. And the mixture of both, it gives it a little bit more of an acoustic sound when you have the microphone in front of it. And so it's like this like really cool way to get a more of an acoustic sounding bass, which sounds perfect for bolero music in a small little scale. So yeah, it's really, really a cool instrument. I just, by the way, the instrument that I got was by Calibrand Music. They make ukuleles. They make those. It's called a U-bass. And I was just, I just got on the roster as a sponsor artist from them. So, you know, it's
all
pretty
right.
Cool stuff.
Well, congratulations on that. All right. And let's just real quickly segue to another type of, you know, as a musician, of course, you got to eat, you got to pay rent. You have to survive during these times. You know, the live shows were taken away from a lot of musicians. They're slowly coming back. But but let's talk about this grant that you recently got from the Eastside Arts Initiative.
Yeah, I found out about the Arts Initiative through Mary, actually, Mary Alfaro. And so I decided to apply for it, you know, doing the breakfast table. Like you said, we all got to eat, and it takes money to make it happen, whether it's feeding the artist, whether it's paying for video production and recording and in editing, promotion and all of that stuff. So I was like, hey, you know what, let me try my piece out and what I'm doing. And I I was blessed to get the grant, and you know, that helps this continue and keeping with the wheels moving of what we're doing here, not just me, because you know, I do have a couple of interns, and my family is very helpful as well. Like, I'll have my sister, sometimes she comes over with her husband to help out in these sessions, because they get a little crazy sometimes. But it helps us keep the lights on and keep on finding artists and keep on sharing this music and keep making this production happen.
All right. Just a real quick plug for the East Side Arts Initiative. It's an initiative of La Plaza de Cultura y Artes. Part of an endowment that was created specifically to help out artists in the northeast part of the LA County. And now they're going into the southeast corner as well. But they've had several rounds of grants. Prior to this, it was a COVID relief, emergency relief for artists and arts organizations that were having a hard time because of the pandemic. This most recent grant awards totaled $150,000 to 5 individual artists and 7 arts organizations, including Future Roots, LA River Project, Methley Projects, and more. You can find all this information on our website at lapca.org. It's in the blog post right there on the front page. You can learn more about these artists. So that's the plug for the Eastside Arts Initiative. And Angie Castro, who's the administrator of this wonderful project. Thank you so much, Angie.
Angie, thank you, Angie.
All right. Well, let's move on to the next one. We have somebody I've never heard of before, Undecided Future.
Yeah, Undecided Future. You know, one of the things, going back to what I said in the beginning, the tapestry of music that is here in LA is something that is very intriguing to me. And so I found these guys. I found these guys on social media as well. And when the first time I saw them, I'm like, man, these guys are something else. The energy that they have, the musicianship that they have. These guys do 5-part harmonies. You know, they got this like soul funk vibe. And they're just fun, a fun group to just see and perform. And I reached out to them. They're from Orange County. I reached out to them and I was like, hey, would y'all be interested in coming on and showcasing your talent on the breakfast table? And they were gracious enough to come by. And so it's different from anything that has been on the breakfast table, but that's also the point of this to, you know, a lot of the audience of the Breakfast Table Decibel Studio, a lot of it is Latino oriented or Latino based, right? Because that's the music that I mainly make and promote and produce and all of that. But I thought this could be a really cool way of showcasing another side of genres. And so Undecided Future, awesome band. So I hope you guys enjoy them. And here we go. One sec. All right.
Welcome to the breakfast table, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to Undecided Future. Let's go!
Destination. Yeah, you know what? You just just gotta keep holding on. Keep hold, keep hold, keep holding on. Ooh, time waits for no one. Moves faster if you slow up. Ha, say,
don't be the lonely one.
Wishing you done showed up.
We can make it last for now, but the chance won't come again.
Writing history.
The chance won't come again.
You feel it next to me.
What do you feel it, baby? Said the chance won't come again.
No matter what you say.
No matter what. Just gotta keep holding on. Keep hold, keep hold, keep holding on. Yeah, time waits for no one. Moves faster if you slow up.
Don't be the lonely one.
Wishing you done showed up.
We can make it last for now, but the chance won't come again.
Writing history.
But the chance won't come again.
You feel it next to me.
But the chance won't come again.
No matter what you say.
No matter what, gotta
That was surprisingly wonderful. That was really, really fun. What a band. I mean, you start off with that guy hyping things up and you don't expect the drummer to start singing. And so many different layers to that. That's a good find, Jesus.
Yeah, no, totally. And that's what drew me to them. I was like, whoa, these guys, you know, they're all singing, they're all harmonizing, and the music is funky. They're all super talented. And yeah, you know, again, just super, super glad that they were able to come by.
Yeah, a couple things there. You know, you have excellent, the camera work is just phenomenal. How many people help out with that aspect?
Well, Adán Alonso's the one behind the camera and the edits and all of that. And it's, so we have 3 to 4 cameras running at the same time. And so that's how we're able to, and it's just him. Like, he'll set it up strategically, right? And then he'll have that the freehand one, and he'll go around to capture the close-ups, to capture the solos, or the, you know, whatever he feels he needs to get. And so, yeah, it's just him handling the camera work. He's amazing. He's awesome to work with. And really, he has brought the production level of the Breakfast Table, I mean, to a whole nother level. I would have not been able to do that, you know, with my iPhone, you know what I mean? Or even the edits that he does. And the really cool thing about Adán is that he's also a musician. And so he understands the ins and outs of, okay, look, here comes this section of the song. Let's see what could work. And that's why I love really working with Adán, because he's excellent at that.
So he's recording on all four cameras, excuse me. And then he edits it afterwards, mixing it with the music.
Correct. Yeah. So what usually happens is we do the session. He takes his four takes of all the songs. I take the takes as well. And usually, you know, the artist that will do each song, they'll do maybe twice. That's usually the amount. Just sometimes they got to warm up. You know what I mean? So they'll do, let's say, song one, right? They'll do song one twice. And so what it is then, okay, the second recording of that song, we're going to keep cool. I make a note and then I start to mix in the music. I start to make sure that nothing's too loud. Make sure that the vocal, you know, is up front, cause it's the main thing. I start mixing and master. Then I master the music. And then I also, then send that out to Adan. He then, puts it together with, aligns everything with the videos, and then he starts to edit it out. And that's, you know, usually he'll give me a call and be like, okay, cool. He'll send it to me. I'll be like, all right, I get my notes down, get with him. And then he gives me the liberty to give him notes and be like, okay, how about we try to put this here, that. So then that at the end we do together.
All right. And another thing is, you know, I imagine that for some of these groups that you're bringing together, this is probably the first time they've been recorded, both in studio, but also in front of the camera. Am I right there?
I'm trying to think if that was actually a thing with any of them. You know, I think I'm not sure that's actually true. Cause if I think about everybody that has been here, maybe in that setting, in a sense of like, it's a little bit more intimate. The camera might be a little bit more on your face. Yeah, maybe you're right in that sense of it, right? Yeah, so in that sense, yeah. And I think sometimes, you know, sometimes we get artists that are a little bit more vocal and are comfortable. And sometimes there's artists like, hey, what do I say? What do you want me to say? You know? And so you got to kind of play the part and be like, okay, I'm going to be a little bit more of a coach now. Oh, I'm going to lay back. This is cool. They can handle it. And so, you know, you just kind of have to see what's going to work in that specific session.
So you're also a director.
I'm also a director. Yeah. a lot of that for sure. I'm also a director to make sure that everything, you know, goes well, things are said correctly, or, you know, whatever it might be. I do my best to give the artists the space and let them do what they want to do with, because that's their time, you know, that this is for them as well to have and showcase. So yeah, you know, I try to give them as much leeway as possible, but some artists just need that, you know, and then they embrace it like, okay, what should I do next? How should I say this and all that? So yeah.
All right. Well, let's listen to that. One more. We got one more, and I'm looking forward to this one with who do you got here? Tell us.
A ver, who got? So, Hermanos Herrera.
Hermanos Herrera.
This was the second session that we did after Lupita Infante. And, you know, I had met one or two of them just randomly at like a musician's party. A friend of mine was having a party. We went, and a bunch of musicians got together. So I had met a couple of them there. But I had always like loved what they do. I mean, they keep that Son Jarocho style of music just alive. I feel like the way that they've played and really came up as musicians, it's just really raw into the soul when it comes to the soul, Son Jarocho, genre. And so I thought, oh, they would be amazing to have. And it's really cool because they're all brothers. And super talented individuals. And that day they came by and they did the song La Bruja, which is a pretty popular song for Dia de los Muertos. And so Dia de los Muertos just passed. So it's kind of makes sense to start with this.
Right.
One.
And Hermanos Herrera were part of the Encuentro Jaraneros there at La Plaza a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, that's right. I did see that they were there. They're amazing, super cool guys. So this is Hermanos Herrera, and we are going to share the screen right now. Okay, here we go.
Cuidado con esa brujita, manito. noche, a las 11 de la noche. Ay, qué bonito es volar, ay, mamá.
Beautiful. All right. Well, that was a fitting end to this En Casa, wonderful, delightful En Casa con la Plaza session with Jesus Martinez and the Breakfast Table.
Awesome. Awesome. Abelardo, thank you very much. As always, La Plaza, thank you very much. Eastside Initiative, Arts Initiative, thank you very much for the continued support. You know, even before we did any of the grant stuff, you know, you graciously, you know, post up the Breakfast Table from the beginning of it. So, you know, all of that means a lot to me. And, you know, I just want to thank you all for everything that you do for not only us here at Decibel Studios, but for all the artists here in Los Angeles.
Well, that's what we're here for. Tell us what's next. What's next for Jesus Martinez and Decibel Studios?
Yeah, well, what's next is that, you know, we're going to continue to bring more artists, and we're hoping not only to get artists from Los Angeles, but from other, you know, other parts of the States and the world. But this next episode, that's for sure going to come up. It's going to be the last Monday of this month. And we actually linked up with Soulful Noise, which is a collective of soul artists in Los Angeles. I went to a soul food place here in downtown LA, and there was like a live band playing, and they were playing like Stevie Wonder songs. They were playing music, Soul Child songs. And I was just blown away by that scene. And I got in contact with them. And so we're going to have two brothers from the Valley, from the 818, named Jake and Papa. And so they're going to come and sing some R&B music for us on the Breakfast Table. So again, something new that we haven't really heard on the Breakfast Table. And then, so that's the point, just pushing through and getting all these genres together for you all to enjoy. And, you know, still continue to make music here at Decibel Studios, arranging and producing and mixing.
Oh, fantastic. All right. Well, we have here on Facebook, Maricela Hernandez with a lot of little claps saying, great music. Thank you for sharing.
Beautiful.
We have Chris Morales. Beautiful. Cannot wait to catch the replay. And yes, we've been recording this. We'll be posting that on our YouTube page at La Plaza LA, on our Facebook page as well. It's going to be there live, and also on our website, lapca.org, where we have all 200 plus of our Casa con la Plaza sessions. And then Teresa Plaza says serendipity. Who knows what serendipity means? I do. I think it's when you catch something by surprise and it's a delight. There you go. Yeah. Thanks for joining us, Teresa Plaza. All right. Okay. Well, Jesus, thank you so much. All of you out there, thanks so much for joining us. As I said, we've recorded this. It'll be on our YouTube page at La Plaza LA, Facebook, and our website as well. Coming up on En Casa con la Plaza next week, a couple of replays, because every now and then we got to take a break here at En Casa con la Plaza. So we're going to be hosting on Monday Dan Guerrero Happy Hour. He's usually on a Friday, but this is a special Monday replay with Jose Luis Valenzuela and Evelina Fernandez. Both of them are the founders of the Latino Theater Company, talking about their career in theater. And then on November 24th, Wednesday at 7 o'clock, both of these will be at 7 o'clock, Chicano Moratorium Aftermath, Four Creative Forces with Jesus Velo, Margarita Cuaron, María Elena Yepes, and Willie Arron, four artists that were impacted by the Chicano Moratorium, which is what we're exhibiting now at En Casa con at La Plaza de Cultura y Artes, excuse me. It's our patriotism and conflict, fighting for country and comunidad, which really centers around the Chicano Moratorium, which took place August 29th, 1970, 51 years ago, but it's still relevant today. And then there's more to come. Check it out on our website, lapca.org. Subscribe to our newsletters. Thanks to our sponsors. I'm going to shout them out again. CVS Health, Aetna, Union Pacific Foundation, California Humanities, National Endowment for the Humanities, Institute of Museum and Library Services. And of course, this program, thanks to the Eastside Arts Initiative for bringing these great artists a little bit of assistance during these troubling and hard times, which we're thankfully getting over. All right. Well, say Jesus.
All right, everyone. See you soon. Take care.
All right. Bye. Bye-bye.